Hello from Athens, Greece. Today we'll see the second part of my lecture in Discord Chess Academy channel, and you will see the discussion after the lecture.
So I was just looking here before. I was just looking here for what I would play.
Mm-hmm.
So if I understand right, here I should first play bishop c6 to restrict the knight.
No. First to put the king as far away as you can in the center. First, you have to put the king in the center. The most important is to activate your king. If your king is in the fifth rank, is another result. If it is on the fifth rank...
The fifth rank is a win, yeah.
Okay, so first of all, you have to activate the king. In all the end games, you should activate your king. There are only two end games that to activate the king is not the first one to do. First of these are where you can create very quickly a passed pawn, the second. And the second one is when you have rook endgames. When you have rook endgames, first of all, you have to make your opponent's rook passive and then to activate the king.
And in all other situations, king activity.
Yes, generally it's king activity except the rook ending. The rook ending is another matter, okay?
So king f6.
Yes. Because if I play here king e5, the position is winning immediately. You see, this is the difference between the king.
Yeah, that king is passive.
Yes, a lot of games you will see Kirill Georgiev play some Sicilians that he has the king on f8. The other didn't understand this. He played this and his opponent king was on g1. And suddenly he lost the endgame very quickly. You can find this in many games of Kirill Georgiev. It's very well known grandmaster.
I have to make this end move. Pencil. Paper. Right.
I don't hear you.
Nope. Sister was screaming her from the stairs.
Yes. You hear my daughter also was screaming sometimes at home.
Does having the king on d4 as a centralized piece provide any additional value over centralizing the king on e5?
Of course. There is a big difference. You see, you can't find some endgames. The king on f6 can be a lost endgame. The king on e5 can be a drawn endgame, and the king on d4 can be a winning endgame. It's very important. One rank farther is another result all the time. It's never the same. That's why you have to understand to activate the king very quickly. That's why you will see in games of many grandmasters that before they exchange, they put the king on g7 or on f8. Just to have this tempo more in the end game.
Another question. When exactly is the moment when the end game starts and, you know, like I can put my king into here?
This is not easy because you have to understand the critical point of the game. Of course, when you exchange queens is something to think about in game, but sometimes you can go to the end game with a queen also. So this is about experience. It's not so easy, but generally your king can activate it when there is no danger for him. Okay, this is the difference between the middle game and end game. In the middle game, your king has to be safe. In the end game, has to play an active part. So when your king is in no danger, he has to come to the battle immediately.
Understandable.
Okay. Don't hear you, sorry. I do not hear you.
I said that it is clear.
Okay. I don't know, any other question?
I think it's not endgame related, but I would like to ask what opening to learn for a beginner? You know, because I would like to master or at least get knowledge in one opening, but I don't know which to choose.
Okay, if you are an amateur, trust me, don't study openings. This is
well,
we all do.
1700 on liches, and you know, I would like just to play something and learn a bit, please.
You see an opening, because just try to play stable openings, because if the opening is tactical, the chess knowledge doesn't matter so much. Matters the theory more, okay? The understanding of chess is easier in the normal positions, in strategical position. So it is according to your style, of course, but for me, don't play, if you just learn chess, don't play all the Sicilians. Doesn't offer you so much. Okay, it is not easy to play this kind of position when you start chess. Just for first, if you want to study the middle game, see a lot of games from good players in different pawn structures. There are 10 pawn structures that are the same all the time. One of these 10 pawn structures happen all the time. One pawn structure are the card back in the minority attack. For example, let's go. Very good question. Let's go. Okay. If you study the cards back, okay, you are with white. You study the cards back. Okay. This is a very well-known position, generally speaking, about... Okay, the idea is to make a castle and to play for rook b1, b4, and minority attack. This is one setup. Okay, the minority attack. If you see some games and you understand some concept of the minority attack, you can play the same with opposite colors. Because what is the problem here? White is playing for an attack on the queen side. Black is playing for the square e4 and for attack on the king side using this square on e4. So, if you play this, you know also this position with reverse color. It's the same position with reverse color. You have one tempo more to use the e5 square for an attack. He has the idea of make a minority attack. That's why you have to study pawn structures. If you study, for example, the isolated pawn, you can have this position out from 20 openings. It's very important to know the 10 basic pawn structure. If you can play this, then you can choose whatever opening you like. For example, new game. I know I was playing C3 Sicilian, okay? Sometimes it was an isolated pawn. Okay, he took and I took the pawn. This is isolated pawn. If I know this and my opponent play the c6, it's about the same. I can play c4. It's about the same. I will have an isolated pawn. Even if my opponent is playing something like Aliyeshin, I can play something very strange here, like this move. If he played d6, this is Sicilian c3. It's the same position. You see, if you understand the pawn structure, doesn't matter what is the opening, because it will come one of the 10 well-known pawn structure. Okay, of course, this is to the 2000 rating, okay, 2200. After, you have to be more specific, of course.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. So you say we should more understand the structure and less learn opening by heart, yes?
Of course. This is the mistake I make. I just learning opening by heart. This is very big mistake, and now that I'm working as a trainer for more than close to 30 years now, this is the same mistake everybody is doing. Try to study the end game, the pawn ending, the rook ending. You can see my channel also, because this is the way I show my students. My students have to study this video, and after we will speak about that game. So you can study this video also, and also try some very classical pawn structures. Okay, there are many classical. The hugging pawns, the isolated. Isolated and hugging pawns are the same. Because if I play in this position knight c3, they will be isolated. If I take here and play knight c3 and you take, they will be isolated. This isolated can come from d4, openings for English opening, from any opening. So study the basic pawn structures. For me, it's very important, because then you can play everything. Doesn't matter theory. Theory matters after 2200.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other? Everything, first of all, sorry to interrupt you, sorry, finish your sequence.
I was just wondering if you thought that it was puzzles and tactics were a productive exercise for beginner players, and instead of learning the 10 well-known pawn structures and light and dark square weaknesses and general ideas about chess, do you think it's more worthwhile venture for beginners to learn tactics or to learn these ideas that you're bringing forth in your videos?
Okay, what you are thinking, it is a beginner. And at what age? Because if you are speaking for a beginner that starts the chess at 25, is not the same like a kid that starts the chess at 5 or 6. So if you speak for a beginner for 1,000, or you're speaking for a beginner or 1,500, you see, there is a difference. That's why I hate that every trainer says the same about the same. It's not the same. Everyone is another person, individual person. Even one boy, if it is strategical or tactical, you have to study the opposite. You see, this is, we do not understand. Whatever you like, you have to study the opposite. Where is your weaknesses? Because according to Dvorevsky, when you have an 8 in strategy, even if you study a lot, you will be close to 9. But if you are 2 in tactical, if you study, you will be 6 or 7. So it will be a very big development of your chess. So if you speak about me for kids that absorb everything very quickly, I think you can start with tactics and also with strategy. Because if you see the games of Morphy, it's strategy. There are a lot of tactics, but basically it is strategy. But if you are after 15, 16, 17, or are you thinking like a grown-up man, then I think it's better, of course, to see the strategy, but also to use some tactical just to keep in touch with the tactical opportunities. Yes, because when you understand something, when you understand the strategy of the game, not the tactics, because the tactics will be one game. If you study, for example, the mate on the last rank, okay, it will come 2, 3, 5, 10 times out of the game, okay. But if you study in game, it will be half of your games. You see, it's more important to understand deeply chess. Tactics are okay if you're. That's why all to my students I said not to play too much Blitz. Blitz is a disaster for chess. If you want to play, it's okay to play some Blitz, but if you go and start in the morning and finish in the night, this is very bad for your chess. You will be destroyed and you will not understand why. Play 10 or 15 minutes. This is chess. Even if it is quick, not less than 10 minutes. Blitz has to be only for fun and not all the time. If you want to improve, if you want to make fun, you can do whatever you like, of course.
I'm taking that one to heart because I play almost exclusively Blitz, and I have not been improving. So,
and just you see what is how we count when your chess is better, when you start playing horrible Blitz. When I make the tour of my grandmaster mode, I was very bad in Blitz, very bad. Because you learn to play quickly. Okay, but it depends, of course. If you are a champion of your country, you play everything well, okay? We speak about the local club player, the club player. Generally, not too much Blitz, not too much of anything.
So it seems like we actually have quite a few more people here now. It seems like quite a few people joined us after we moved from the lecture channel to Chess Talk. For those of us just joining us, if you have any questions for International Master Andreas, please feel free to unmute and ask a question. We're sort of in the post-lecture digestion talk right now. So if you have any questions or anything to comment in general, just, you know, feel free to unmute and ask a question.
Yes.
I think we also have people writing things down in lecture chat. So wannabe International Master Clara asks, what's the best way to study triangulation? Does it come with experience or is analysis the best way?
There are a lot of patterns in the endgame. Okay, triangulation is well known for the motif of Farni Alapin. One moment. Put a position. Okay, so if there is a pawn here, just to understand the triangulation, because it's very easy not to understand the triangulation. Okay, what is the triangulation? The triangulation just to pass the move to your opponent. That is the triangulation, to lose a tempo. This is the meaning of triangulation. Okay, we see this, we can do it with a bishop move, as in the example that we show. But here is the meaning of the triangulation. In this position, if white is going to d6, black is going, to d8, taking the opposition. Okay, if I'm coming to c5, he's coming to c7. So the idea of the triangulation is not just to make a triangle. Is just to lose a tempo, so to have the same position, so we play. So what I'm doing? Another can do this not with triangulation, because we will see I win with this idea, to make a triangle. Another will think that is a opposition, long opposition. I take the opposition, and now I'm coming here because you cannot take the opposition. So it's the same position, wherever you go, you are losing. You see, is not, you have to understand the concept. Concept is triangulation, but the idea of triangulation is to lose a move. And it's your turn to play. Because half of the end games are lost with Zugzwang. Zugzwang is that you have no move, and half of them are lost because you have a passed pawn. Okay, so it's not that regulation the concept. The concept is how to lose a move. Okay, of course there is some very difficult example with regulation, but that not help. These examples that not help practically. Okay. Other question?
Yep, I think that we have Hef here, who's another one of our lecturers, and he's been asking if he can ask a question. So, Hef, did you want to ask
everyone.
Anything?
Yes, everyone can ask. One moment, maybe a bit unrelated. What is your favorite book? Is this Fave? Behind you, Fave. What is Fave?
Favorite.
Favorite. Behind me, as you see, this is a is not my only library. You can see this one. Now you can see two more here. And these are not two, are four, because each one, there are two ranks of books. And there are two with Russian books on the other side. So, how it's a favorite book? Cannot be a favorite book. Everyone is fantastic. I think an interesting book to study chess and to understand is the Zürich 1953, Zürich, but from Bronstein, because it has a lot of ideas and interesting comments. This is an interesting book to start. But of course, there are a lot of books. Okay, also sorry, my English are not my favorite language. Okay, I speak more fluently Russian and French and Greek. But okay, I learn from the chess books only. What book you would recommend for roughly 9,000? Okay. Yes, I said about Zürich 1953. Okay, one. Very nice, we have so many questions. So, what book I recommend for roughly 1,900? When you have 1,900, you have to understand what type of player you are. You are strategical player or tactical player. So, whatever you are strong at, you have to study the other one. If you are very strong in the tactical vision, you have to study strategically. So, you can study games of Karpov or Kramnik or Petrosyan, but with the comments of themselves, not from others. It's very important. Okay, also Botvinnik, it's fantastic. If you go early intermediates, early intermediates has to be about 1,500. It's about the same. It's about the same. Generally, you have to study all the stages, so you don't have weaknesses to anyone. So you have to study some basic end games with pawns, rook, or bishops, okay, and some general strategic themes on the end games, but also you have to make some practice tactics and see some games from the good players. This is, in order to be a good player, you have to be thirsty for chess. You have to think chess a lot, to have the chess always on your mind. This is very important. Okay, one of my biggest talents here in Greece is Dimitris Makridis. Makridis is now 12, 13. Now he just became 13. He's about 2,250. But all the time he's thinking about chess. Okay, we work 3 years now, and he came with 500 ranking points. But he was studying all the time. This is the important, not the trainer. The trainer can give you some rules how to study. But the important is to love chess, not to play all the time blitz, because if you play all the time blitz, it's not only that you make problem for your chess understanding, it is the problem you don't have time to think what are you studying, and there is not too much time to study. If you play chess 10 times, 10 hours every day, how to study chess? With what mind? Your mind will be very tired. How do you study pawn structures? No, I don't speak five languages. No. It's my English are terrible. I'm very optimistic, but I know my level. I'm 1500. So, how do you study pawn structures? A very good book. It was Winning Pawn Structure from Baburin, from Batchford, the old Batchford, that it is speaking generally about the isolated and the hanging pawns. The same, eh?
Although probably. I do think, while you're getting set back up, I think that we had one more interesting question from Hef. He asked if there were any book recommendations on Akiva Rubinstein that were not in descriptive notation.
Yes, of course. There are, I think, there are one now, but the most very good books about Akiva are the two by Donaldson and Minev. There are two books that they are not descriptive because they make a new publication. It is algebraic, I think, notation. It's okay. The best resource to learn from, books or videos. Generally, I'm a little bit old, Killer Queen. Now I'm close to 50, 48. So for me, I learn to study with books. Of course, video can help you. That's why I produce also videos. So it will be easier for everyone to study chess. I think it's a matter of taste, okay? But it's not the same, because if you want to see some books with the comments of Rubinstein, there is no videos. You see, you have to find what is your weakness, what you want to study, and accordingly to study books or videos. Okay, they're both okay, I think. Who will win? Lose? No. Magnus will not lose his champion's title very close to here. He's the best player in the world by far, and for some more years he will be. Okay, Ferrugia lost opponent games. This is unbelievable. Okay, maybe he, but for now I think Carlsen will stay the world champion for years. Many years. Okay, 5, I don't know, and we'll see. 4-5 years, I think it will be. Sources, okay, who will win?
I saw a game recently where it was Alireza Ferrugia versus Magnus Carlsen, and for 48 straight moves, the average centipawn loss was 0.1, you know, 0.1, point, half a centipawn, and then on move 48, Alireza makes one mistake, and then the game just tumbles out from there. So it's insane to see.
It was a pawn and game.
Yes, it was a pawn and game.
Okay, but this pawn and game is very simple for anyone. You cannot play this. Okay, just keep the long opposition. This is very easy for anyone who studied. Okay, it was tired. There was pressure on him, but this is the problem, because they play with the computer. They know how to work with the computers, so they think like computers. But okay, this is can be objectively the best chess, but we play also chess, because chess we play not just to be champions. We play chess just to improve our character, to help us see the weakness of our character. So it's better not to work like a champion. It's better to understand what you want from chess and work accordingly, in my opinion.
Would you say that most of your growth personally has come from you wanting to associate chess with the improvement of your character, or would you say that you've at any point wanted to improve specifically at chess for competitive means?
I think that in the beginning I was very young. I started chess at 12, and I was at 16 champion of Greece in under 16, after 18, and also in junior champion, and also in Greek champion. But I think in the beginning you are a young boy, you cannot improve your character. Maybe even you are a bad character in the beginning, because you want to win everything, you don't think about anything else. So this is because now I have the experience to understand my mistakes. Okay, generally, chess is a very good way to look into you. Okay, it is very sad that a lot of people does not analyze his game. If you do not analyze, most of my students analyze his games for many hours. It's a very important concept because you have to understand what is your weakness. Generally, you will see the same weakness in your life. If you are a player very attacking, that's the way you are in your life. You cannot be the opposite, generally. So if you study something in chess, it will help you generally. If you study what your opponent is thinking, that is the best, very best concept about the evaluation, you evaluate the position, and the first thing to do after is how your opponent is thinking. If you can do this, then you can do this in life also. Because I see a lot of husbands and wives, and no one thinking what his wife is thinking. This is very bad. You have to think what your friend, your wife, is thinking also. So chess helps you in this way. Okay, there are a lot of things that chess will help you understand.
Maybe a bit of a cheeky question. I'm sorry, I actually interrupted somebody.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, as a bit of a cheeky question, do you think, do you have any specific examples of top players who you think character is holding them back from adjusting their play style? Do you know any?
You see, now it's very difficult because a lot of progress is about the computer. Okay, if you study all the concept with a good trainer, you will be a very good player. You see, all the top players now are between 15 and 25, 27. Okay, but you cannot be a very good man knowing all your weakness at a very early age. Okay, we can see this. Sometimes also when the Magnus was younger, okay, he makes some comments that were a little bit arrogant, but okay, it was his humor. So, but this can easily be misunderstood by some people. So you see, you are not completely a perfect guy when you are so young. Of course, you will have weaknesses. It's normal. But in order, if you see the previous generation before computer, like Kramnik, Anand, okay, you have to make to see your weaknesses and to repair, not to have these weaknesses. So generally, you will see that the 10 best players in the world before computer era was generally good persons. Okay, generally, of course there are exceptions, but sometimes you cannot do other way. If you are in Eastern country in other years, it was not easy. Okay, I can understand this. If you have to live through chess, if you are from one country, there is no money, you cannot live. Of course, you will sell games, you will buy games. Because as I think Socrates said, that in order to survive, first you survive, and then you think about ethical. Okay, so if there is no this problem, I think a lot of players make corrections, a lot of correction about the character.
I want to ask about moving. I mean, first of all, thank you very much for taking the time to do this. I really appreciate it. I missed the lecture, but this is a great chance to kind of pick your brain. I've been playing chess for around 3 or 4 months now, and something that I'm struggling with is kind of forming plans on a broader scale, and kind of I'm a very, like, I don't like taking risks. So when I see that there's a possibility to go for something, I really like to calculate it completely, but obviously I can't always. So only if I see, like, I have two rooks and like two bishops and a queen pointing at my opponent's king, I go for an attack when I sacrifice pieces. And that's only the only kind of plan that I formulate, if it makes sense, because it's so obvious that it will work. But otherwise, if it isn't like easy to calculate it, I'm like, okay, I mean, I could go start pushing this pawn and like make a game plan around that, but it's like I can't calculate if it's going to work, if that makes sense. So kind of what I would like to ask is how can one improve in making plans in general, and kind of to traverse the kind of between tactics and strategy, if that makes sense. like things that you can't reasonably calculate to perfection.
Yes, but you see, that's why I told before, if you are a tactical player, you have to calculate well. If you don't calculate well, you have to choose sometimes that they are more strategical. Okay, some position more strategical. For example, of course there are some rules, because a very easy rule to know is, in order to make an attack, you need three, how to say, preposition. You need to have three things. Okay, the first one is that the center has to be close, okay, or to control very well the center. You cannot make an attack when your opponent has a pawn break in the center. You have to bring quickly your pieces to the opening king and to create weaknesses around his king. So you see, most of them are rules. So if you have the rules, you know what to do. Then you need the calculation, because you may think that it is the calculation, but if you make an attack, okay, and you don't have any of these three rules, your attack will be failed. It's the easiest way to lose is for your opponent to let you make this attack. So these are a lot of simple rules that after these rules comes the calculation. So sometimes we don't know the rules and we think it is the problem of the calculation, but this is not correct. Okay, calculation on the other side, you have to improve with many exercises. Because sometimes if you play an open Sicilian with white, you have to go for an attack. If you don't have calculation, don't open the Sicilian. You see, it's very simple concept. If I'm not want to have an arm, okay, I'm not going to war. I don't go into the army. What you know, you have to play accordingly to that. You are a strategical, go to strategical positions. You are a tactical, go to tactical. If you are, you cannot take risk, you are not a tactical player. Why you play tactical positions? Play slowly positions, strategically, study a lot of end games, and you will win easily. You have sure. That's why you have to understand your weakness. Sometimes you must not fix your weakness. Okay? Sometimes you can just put the game where you are strong at. This is easier.
Yeah, I'd like to think that I'm in many games, I play very conservatively. I don't like take risk, and I like to kind of let my opponent make the mistake and then like exploit it. But people repeatedly say that at some point you should kind of learn to like make plans, even if you are not an attacking player, that you should like, have a plan in a game of chess. And an attack is a very obvious example of it, but are there kind of other kinds of plans, and like what are the kind of ways to start forming strategical ideas? Because currently kind of I only see like, okay, there's a pin or this diagonal, you know, those are basic kind of conceptual things, but they don't like form plans by themselves. So kind of, I don't know if I'm communicating this well, but it's kind of easy to play chess like, I'm just going to see what happens and try to avoid blundering pieces, which, you know, might not be the best.
Yeah, but this is not the right way to play chess, okay? First of all, you have to understand how to make an evaluation. And another very interesting thing that we spoke about Papaioannou that is not in the book, it was published only recently in the book of Pump Your Rating by Axel Smith, is that all the times the plan has to do with pawn breaks in the center. So I want to give an example. I hope I don't lose the screen. I will share the screen so you will understand what you said. Can you see the screen? Or I have to share it? Okay. So now you can see the screen. Yes.
Yes. Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. So I played d4. For example, just see a queen and king's Indian, and well-known opening to anyone. Okay. Just understand one, two concept. Okay, he play here. And now, I can play this, or I can make castle. And after knight c6 to play this. Okay. It seems the same. It's not the same, because if I am strategical player, the good idea is not to make a castle, because I have to play d5, because the knight are coming to the same squares. So the position will be strategically, will be more strategical. If I play castle, then as you can see, the knight are coming not to the same position, to the same squares. They are close to each other, so the battle will be more tactical. You see, you choose what you will play. Even if you don't understand, because maybe this is a little bit difficult now, but generally, if you see also in this position, let's see this normal position, d5, what are the plan for this side? Can you tell me the plan of this side? How to formulate what is the right plan for white and for black? So, here we have two pawn breaks. So, white's plan has to do with one of these two moves. Okay, black plan has to be one of these three moves. But this is, you can think in 1 second. The right answer is which one? Okay, so here we have to think. So, let's think for white. If I play with f4, okay, then he can take, he opened the bat bishop, and he can attack my pawn. So, f4 is not the good for me. So, I have to play for c5. Also, according to Nimzowitsch, when I'm attacking a pawn chain, I'm attacking not in the head, okay? I'm attacking on the base of the pawn chain. And base is not c7, as many will think. Base are the blockaded base. Base are the d6. So all the rules tell you to play for c5. So white will play for c5. What black will do? Of course, cannot choose, because white is playing first. White has more space. So white will play on the queen side with c5. So you have no other plan than to go for f5. You see, if you have the rule and the basic concept, you can understand what to do. That is just an example. Okay?
Yeah, that makes sense. I guess, would that be kind of, what's the word? Kind of, not concentrated, but, well, anyway, abbreviated into meaning that if you kind of take note of basic principles, the plan will kind of form itself, or?
Of course. If you, that's why we study very different pawn structure for many good players. Okay, so for example, you are very weak in the attack or the calculation. See some games with people that playing very well with initiative. You have to work on games of Tal and Kasparov, because it's not your style, just to understand the style that you don't play. Okay? Anything else? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, anything else to ask?
Does anybody else have any questions for Andreas?
Okay, then we can call it, and after some time you can make another one if you want some subject, or you can propose what you like or something like this.
Yeah, that would be amazing. Thank you so much for coming out today, especially the extra hour of conversation that we got to.
No, it's nothing. It's nothing. Just send me the video. I will put it also in my channel. And if you like it, see my channel and subscribe to have more people to see it. Okay, thank you all from my side.
Thank you so much. We'll be sure to post your channel here, as well as your playlist that you were referring to earlier. And yeah, I mean, we would love to have you again, so I'm sure that we can set that up if you'd be amenable. So thank you so much, International Master Andreas.
It was my pleasure. My pleasure. Good night to all of you.
Good night. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks, everybody.